has been entitled The Church Under the Cross, and each week we've been focusing on an aspect of our life together as the church. And tonight's the final installment, and it is The Church United in Mission. So we'll begin with our hymn. We'll sing 837, Lift High the Cross, stanzas 1, 2, 3, and 4. Please sing.
Grant that by your Holy Spirit we may be
The psalm for this evening, Psalm 139. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. O Lord, you have searched me and known me.
You know me.
You search out my path and my lying down. Even before a word is on my tongue. You have me in, behind and before. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. If I would count them, they are more than the sand.
I awake and I am still with you.
Search me, O God, and know my heart.
Try me, and know my thoughts.
And see if there be any grievous way in me.
Gospel of our Lord.
series over these 6 weeks. We were cut short a week, but over this Lenten time period, the title of the series has been The Church Under the Cross. And we've been focusing on each week on some aspect of our life together as a church. And so tonight, the final installment, the church united in mission. You know, mission is a funny word. Mission, missions, missionaries. As a kid in Sunday school, they give me a little cardboard box. Remember that? Give me a little cardboard box with a slit on top. And they tell us, now I want you to take your pennies and your dimes and quarters and nickels and stick them in this little box. And they're for what? They're for missions. And occasionally they show us pictures. Sometimes they show us, and I bring them a real, you know, film projector, and they show us movies of missionaries in far-off lands, you know. There'd be missionaries in Thailand, and missionaries in China, and all these far-off places, Botswana, Pacific Islands, you know, all these palm trees and coconuts. And they tell us, this is your mission money at work. And then they hand us another box, and we have to start all over again with our quarters and pennies and dimes and nickels. And so, when I look back, at least they taught us a few things. The one thing, fine, that as Christians, we're all supposed to be involved in mission work. So we got that, even though we were little kids, we got that much. And then they made it clear that missions is about other people. It's about other people who don't know Jesus. So we got that part. Mission is about other people getting to know Jesus, about them hearing the story of his love for all of us. But inadvertently, they taught us that missions and mission work is something that only takes place in far-off places. And not my own neighborhood. I never thought of missions as being something in my own neighborhood. And being a missionary meant being sent to some faraway place. That was my father's great fear when I told him I was going to be a pastor. He says, I'm going to make you a missionary. And he told me, and he looked so troubled. I said, what's the problem? He says, they're going to send you to some far place. The cannibals are going to eat you. He actually said that at the dinner table. And I told my wife, they can't send me without my permission to go overseas. And I don't think you truly believe that. But it was only later at the seminary, I think, that I began to realize that mission is something as local as the house next door. Or even the people under your own roof. And we're all, in a sense, called to be missionaries, bearing the good news of Jesus to those around us. And it's just as much a local thing, and perhaps even more so than a foreign thing. Although it's that too. And this became more and more impressed upon me once I was in the parish. And I began to notice that an increasing number of people didn't know anything about Christianity. And you know, when I started out in 1983, coming out of seminary, as we moved through the 80s and into the 90s, and then into the 2000s, more and more people, I realized an increasing number of people didn't know church, certainly, and didn't know really much of anything about the Christian message. And the real thermometer
nice there. And I realized they didn't have any background. Zero. They were two, three generations out. As time went on. So, here are the facts you need to be aware of that I mentioned on Sunday briefly ago. 30,746 people living in South Buffalo, just in South Buffalo. You know, I'm sure, you know, a lot of those are probably within walking distance of the church. Most of them, the vast majority of them, do not belong to a church. Fact. That's not hypothesis. That is a fact. And they know very little about the Christian faith. Most people living in this area, as in most areas, are not Christian. And even those who claim to be are most probably inactive or unaffiliated. And that was not always the case. There was a time in South Buffalo when most of the people were Christian. Probably the favorite flavor was Roman Catholic. But then you had Presbyterian Church down the street, it isn't there anymore. You had a Methodist church on the corner, it isn't there anymore. A number of the Roman Catholic churches are gone. Still people living in the mountain. A Christian community, those days are gone. And we could spend a whole lot of time talking about the cultural shift and all that's taking place. And we could spend all kinds of time reminiscing about how things were in the good old days. And we could wish things were different, but that's not going to change anything. The fact of the matter is, the majority of people in this region, and by the way, the Northeast United States is one of the most unchurched regions of the country. And I had a list in my office of the 50 most unchurched cities in the country, and guess what was on the list? Buffalo. Out of all the cities in the nation, it was on the top 50 unchurched. Isn't that something? Surprising, doesn't it? And what that means is that without even leaving our region, without getting on a boat or a plane, we're all missionaries in a very real sense of the term. In fact, if we traveled by boat or plane to some of those far-off countries, we would find them far more Christian than we are. Say Nigeria or the south of Sudan, we would probably find ourselves in a much more churched area than the one in which we reside. The largest Lutheran church in the world. You know where it is?
Philippines.
Nope.
Ethiopia.
Ethiopia. Missouri Lutheran Church, Missouri City. That's approximately 1.8 million, used to be more, much larger. 1.8 million, there's under 2 million people. Lutheran Church in Ethiopia, 8 million. So if we think we're big, we don't know what big is. Those words, he was very shortly, go to the cross. It was on the horizon.
will draw people. The message of the cross, of how much God loves us, that he was willing to send his son to die for us and rise again for us. He was willing to send his son to the cross. He says that message is going to be like a magnet to bring people to God. So our job is what? Hold forth the cross in as many ways as possible, in as many creative ways as possible. Get the message out. But above all, we need to be committed to the task. And Paul talks about this. He says, I become all things to all people, but I mean, we in some. He says, I'm going to do my best to relate to all people, with the goal being, I want to be able to communicate with them this message of redemption and grace. So this is the mission we share, and everything we do as a church, this is the way we have to, I think of the church, that everything we do relates in some way to this mission. To this mission. Having a common goal is a really good thing for a church. It makes for a healthy church. When everybody's kind of on the same wavelength. And the best part of all, we're doing our part to swell the population of heaven. Thank you, my Heavenly Father, for Jesus Christ during his Son, as you have graciously kept me this day. And I pray that you would forgive me all my sin, where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For in your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, merciful.